Hello and welcome to the Core WEC Monza Race 1. I'm Adam Weller and today I am joined in the commentary box by Tom Chorley. Hello, Tom.
Hello, Adam. It's good to be here for this one.
Yes, it's your first time commentating with us and I think this is going to be a particularly nice debut for you because Monza often provides good racing.
It certainly does. I mean, look at the last two races we've had here in Season 1 and 2, obviously, and yeah, we've thrown up some surprises previous occasions and obviously more powerful cars this year, so yeah, we should be in for a good race. Slightly unexpected to see the Peugeot still on pole position, as we expected the lower downforce configuration for Monza to favour the Bentley and the Audi, but who knows, maybe they'll come good in the race.
Yeah, I definitely was surprised to see that Peugeot stay out front. Obviously it's been, you know, towards the front all season in the LMP class, but I must say I had my bets on Mini Stiggy in that Audi in second, but he just got pipped to the post by Ninchin, and I think that those two are going to have a fight all throughout the race.
Indeed, that's likely to be the case. Of course, Ayrton Schumacher making his debut as well in the core WEC series, having last year been a star in the Rising Stars series, but it's taken him a while to finally get here into the big leagues, so to speak. So yeah, it should be interesting between the top three, and of course Chozza there in fourth place can never be counted out for too long, and Glenn, and then we've got Mems obviously filling in for the IMP team in place of Immortal Pilot, so it'll be interesting to see what he can do, having thrown something together at the last minute.
It will be, yes, and of course one thing I've just literally just realised is that we are moments away from going green. In previous races we have had two formation laps due to a glitch from Polyphony Digital, but this has now been amended, so we are about to go green here.
We are, yes, as you can now see we have a time counter on the screen, as we now have a proper 2-hour endurance race, so any second once Ninchin decides to drop the throttle and lead the pack out of Parabolica, we'll be racing for slightly less than 2 hours, obviously. But as we get ready for the action here, as Nin on his third pole position of the season, 6th overall for a Peugeot, it'll be interesting to see who can make the jump onto the first corner.
Bunching up here. Will they go?
Peugeot really taking his time waiting to drop the throttle. And away we go, though, and Nin's made early break for it. He says they all group up just behind him. It looks like Nin's still got lead going to first corner. The Audi still maintaining second. Chozza challenging there for third position, as Memso has also got the jump on Glenn. But it's still the Peugeot leading as they head down towards the second chicane. And Memso will be looking to get past the notoriously slow and straight line Pescarolo as they go into the second chicane. But Chozza's got the inside line, I think, so it's as they were, apart from Memso jumping, although all the Audi looks a bit out of shape there on the exit of the kerbs.
Yeah, once again, getting the power down in that Audi is apparently rather hard, I've heard from the paddock from various drivers, because of the rather large turbo that's been bolted on.
Yeah, so it's got quite a powerful turbo attached to the Audi. It's some 730 horsepower it runs at, even though in standard format it's normally about 500, whereas we see Memso again, is he challenging Ayrton Schumacher going towards Ascari? I think he is. He's having a great first lap as Memso.
Did you see that there? There was also some dust being kicked up both at Ascari and at the Lesmo corner, so clearly some of the drivers getting a bit out of shape in these early laps.
Yeah, so they're clearly going for it from the word go here, and as now we've got Chozza on the back of the Audi, is it? So Chozza has sneaked past Ayrton Schumacher as well in the midst of all this, and now I don't think the Pescarolo is going to be able to have the run on the Audi down the straights, as the Audi is undoubtedly the fastest in the straight line. The Pescarolo all season has struggled, and yet you can see the Audi just inching away, making it difficult for Chozza on the run into the first chicane, so he has to slot behind into third. Oh, the Audi. Oh, he's got well out of shape on that one. That's allowed the Pescarolo through in second. And he's dropped down to fourth as well and could go down to fifth even by the time he gets to second chicane. So, as we were talking a moment ago, the power
that
Audi.
Oh, Memso 89.
That was definitely a white purge off in the background. So, that is Memso, who has somehow gone off in the middle of the Curva Grande there. It was very unusual. He must have had some form of issue to go off in the middle of there. So problems for the Peugeot on the word on second lap, but the other Peugeot, of course, still leading quite comfortably now from the Pescarolo, Chozza 32, as we see Cabani there kicking up some dust. Still some action further down. Nico Demas, of course, leading the GT pack at the moment from Cabani. Davey B in third position in GT.
Yes, I think that this could be a good battle, Nico and Cabani. I reckon those two drivers are equals. I think that they will... this will be a good battle, I think it's going to be interesting to watch this play out over 2 hours.
It certainly will be, although the Ford is... it's more of a corners car, when you say. It's not always been the fastest down the straight, so it'll be interesting to see here as we get... the battle cars are good in the straights versus those in the corners, as we see Memso and TNR Filo there in the other Pescarolo doing battle for especially last of the LMP runners here.
Rather lower down than I expected Memso to be in that Peugeot that he's so familiar with from the first two seasons of WEC.
That is true, but of course there's been a fairly significant change in the regulations between the last couple of series and this one, so he'll have been very unfamiliar with it compared to previous years, and of course he's been used to driving the Bentley for the first it's not been the first six races, it's been the last three, hasn't it? The first three races Audi, then three races in the Bentley, and now been thrown into the Peugeot for this one race whilst his teammate normally is doing the business in the Bentley. So Memso, it's only a jack of all trades when it comes to driving variety of cars.
Yeah, definitely so. And of course, not only did I neglect to think of the fact that we've had some rule changes, but we've also switched games since season two, of course. So probably very, very different. I was probably slightly overlooking things there. I should apologise to Memso.
I say, yeah, the game physics are quite different, aren't they, between Gran Turismo 5 and Gran Turismo 6. But the drivers, of course, are well used to it by now. We've got a good scrap going on for effectively second place as Ninchin and the Peugeot is still inching away from Chozza 32 in second place. Ayrton Schumacher hanging on in third place there. And then we've got Glenn trying to fend off the faster Audi for fourth at the moment after the American JF5 is looking to make up from that mistake he made at the start of lap two.
Yep, JF5 or Mini Stiggy. He goes by many names. I think I prefer the Mini Stiggy personally. A lot, much less complicated.
Yes, you're right. Mini Stiggy does sound better than
Ningen sucks there. Bit, yeah, probably just put the power down a fraction too early on the curb.
Being out of Roger chicane there, say that. They're very challenging, the chicanes here, aren't they, Adam? They're not... You can't just throw the car over them as such. There's a variety of stages of curbs, isn't there? So you've got to be exceptionally precise with how you attack them.
Yeah, you do. It's not as straightforward as it seems. It might just be a case for some people. Might just think it's a case of brake and just kind of feather through it and then put the hammer down. But sometimes it's not quite that simple, and mistakes are easily made at corners like that.
Yeah, certainly as Ninchin showed there, trying to get past the first of the GT drivers, Psycho Pera, in last place. So he lost a bit of ground there, and that's enabling Chozza. Oh, it's the BMW running wide and has gone off there at Parabolica. And as
TNR
we see,
Pesco
dropping down as well. So it's not going well at the moment for TNR Filo or Psycho Pera.
No, definitely not. Early troubles here, and Chozza 32, however, he seems to be having a decent start to this race, leapfrogged a couple of positions and keeping Ayrton Schumacher at bay, and I'm impressed with our debutant here in the Bentley. I think he's doing quite well for himself.
He certainly is, and of course, it's, as we mentioned, it's his first race, and as we've seen, some people, it can take them time to get familiar with these online races, as of course the core field is renowned for its competitiveness. It's doing a good job at the moment with the fastest lap at the moment for Ayrton Schumacher of 1 minute 30.996, we can see on our live timing. So they're all lapping within a similar pace, actually, the top five in the LMP. Nin so far has put in the fastest lap of 30.5, and of course he'll want to extend his gap as much as he can, because he probably knows later in the race the bigger threat will come from the likes of the Audi and the Bentley as opposed to that Pescarolo.
Yeah, valid point there. And one guy I'm surprised to see quite so far down in the early stages is Pikey Mikey in this McLaren. He's usually right up there towards the front, isn't he?
He is, yes. And clearly, we haven't seen it on screen, but I don't know if he's had an issue at some point or whether the McLaren's just not proven that competitive around Monza. But we do see that sometimes, don't we? Because there's a, it's not quite a case of taking all the downforce off and then running in minimum drag as it would be, say, at Le Mans or anywhere else. Because perhaps for a GT car and a LMP car, there's too many corners still compared to overall straights, as you would have to say in Formula One. So there's definitely more of a balance to be struck here between, you know, still obtaining some corner speed and particularly to help under braking with the downforce.
Yes, of course. I mean, there's the likes of the Lesmos, the Ascari chicane and Parabolica, and you do need downforce to get the optimum speed around those corners, don't you?
Yes, we certainly do, as you can see, fellow, you can imagine the Pescarolo, they probably had to take off a reasonable amount of downforce because, as we know, their car is normally the slowest in the straight line of the LMPs, so you can imagine they've still got a reasonable amount on because they've got to retain their car strengths, obviously. But as you say, at the moment, actually, the Bentleys are looking good as Ayrton Schumacher is starting to close up a bit on Chozza.
Yes, just slightly. It seems we're having a bit of a period where they're all just kind of gapping and forming their own little groups. You've got Nin, who seems to be dragging away from the rest of the field slightly. You've then got Chozza and Ayrton Schumacher, who are battling for second. And then you've got these two, Glenn and Mini Stiggy, in the battle for fourth.
Indeed, and the Audi looks to have a good run on the Bentley here, does he? It'll be a brave move down the inside, and it's perhaps too far back on that occasion, but of course, eventually, as tyre wear starts to become an issue later on the stints, it might open opportunities. The Bentley is perhaps renowned for being the hardest on its tyres of the LMPs.
Yeah, I think that's probably correct. But of course, it does depend slightly on setup. I'm sure something can be done to maybe get another lap or so out of it. But I think no matter what you do have to try and preserve those that rubber on the Bentley. It's just a car that seems to get through its tyres quickly, no matter what.
Indeed. It should benefit Glenn, as of course Memto is someone who is very good at setting up a car and spends his time getting a setup as good as it can possibly be for the Bentley. So, and then he passed that on to his teammates. So of course, as a unit, they are stronger as a result of sharing information, as the Audi's got a good run there out of Ascari. And is he going to get past the Bentley before he even got into the Parabolica? I think he has.
He has made it through.
As you can see, the speed line advantage that Audi really demonstrated there. And that's against the Bentley, which is probably the second best in terms of straight line speed. So theoretically cruise past the likes of the Pescarolo and Peugeot if you can get up behind them later on.
Yeah, and going back to what you said about Memto and his prowess when it comes to setting up race cars, I remember one time back when I first got involved with Core, with the Rising Stars series, he gave me a setup for the Amuse S2000 GT1 that was the GTE car in the series, and I thought it was the best thing ever. About 2 months later, I mentioned the fact that I'm still using this setup, and he just laughed at me and said that he basically moved on to bigger and better things. So he's constantly evolving his cars.
He is. He never stands still, does Memto, as we at the moment see the Peugeot and Nin quite comfortably on his own at the moment. So he is doing what he usually does, just banging in consistent lap times again and again as he just eventually gets past. Let's say, you'd always hope around here to catch a GT car on the straights, but of course you've got to be careful when you catch them on the exit corners like that.
You just can't relax here, can you? You can't really relax anywhere in a multi-class race. You can say you're comfortable, but as soon as you come up on a GTE car, or particularly a group of GTE cars, then you might be a bit tense.
As we see and Schumacher ever closer to the back of that Pescarolo. And is he going to be thinking about challenging into turn one at the moment? He's thinking about it.
He's trying to squeeze up.
Charles just leaves him some room as the Mazda is complicating the issues, but hopefully it's given Charles the inside line. If he hangs it around the outside of the Curva Grande, he'll keep the inside line for the Roger chicane. He has the Bentley's notoriously faster in a straight line, so it's going to be a brave man on the brakes to retain the lead going into or second place. And Charles has, with a late brake move, kept a hold of second place there.
Yes, impressive stuff there. How long can he keep this up? At the end of the day, it's good to be a great defensive driver, but that can only go on so long. Eventually you will slip up, or you will simply run out of speed and the driver behind will get you.
Indeed, as we've seen over definitely his time in LMPs, Charles has shown a tendency to make a lot of mistakes when under pressure after a while, so the form book would suggest that after a while he will probably yield to the Bentley through mistake more than anything else.
Maybe so. I mean, he's showing some good consistency at the moment. It's a question of whether he can keep that up. And as you said, the archives sometimes show a tendency to make the odd pressurized mistake. So it's going to be fun to find out what happens there in that battle for second position that the Audi of Mini Stiggy looks to be rapidly closing up on.
He does. We've not seen on screen. He has dispatched of the Bentley. Oh, wait, we saw that a while ago, didn't we? So he's certainly making up ground now whilst he's got some clean air. And yeah, as you say, he's within about a second now of that Bentley. So things are certainly looking promising for the Audi. But of course, he's then got a big gap if he can get past the two in front of him to that leading Peugeot, who is just serenely and consistently pulling away some more. It's a tune now of about 6 seconds is Nin's lead after only 11 laps. So on average, he's pulling half a second a lap out of his pursuers at the moment.
Good stuff here, as I think we can officially say that this is more of a free car battle than anything here for second position.
Indeed, and the GT traffic forever blurring the line some more as runs it deep going into Ascari, whether that was him taking his eye off the ball as the LMPs were coming up, or one of them gave him a gentle nudge into the gravel there. We'll have to wait and see if he complains to the stewards after the race and they can investigate it. But for the moment, the LMPs press on. There's no point in loitering around thinking you've made some forward mistake. Just better get on with it and then worry about the repercussions later.
Yeah, I mean, in some cases, I imagine drivers know they've done something a little naughty or something that breaches the regulations. And I imagine there have been cases where drivers have intentionally tried to make up for that and make up knowing full well they'll probably end up getting a penalty.
Yes, as we, I'm not sure if you would remember, Adam, back to season two at Laguna Seca, where Memto, class of the field on his day, unfortunately hit one of the Audi drivers early on, and knowing full well that he was going to incur a minute penalty then for avoidable contact, drove out of his skin for the rest of the race to build up a good 50 second lead or so by the end of the race. But it still wasn't enough, unfortunately, and his hard work resulted in a net fourth place back then. So you might have seen cases of drivers pushing hard when they know that got a penalty incoming, but we'll wait and see if any of that plays out later on. As we see Nico still serenely leading the GT field at the moment, as Cabani seems to have dropped off the back of him.
Yes, he has rather, hasn't he? Obviously, there was that mistake in the gravel a couple of laps ago here at the Ascari chicane, and I think that probably cost him 2 or 3 seconds, but I think in general Nico's just pulling away at the moment, obviously at a track that favours straight line speed cars such as the Corvette.
Yes, in the past we've seen the American cars, we say the Viper, the Corvette, the Camaro, and their obviously sheer brute force has often gone well at places like Monza and Le Mans. Whenever there's plenty of straights on a track, the likes of the Corvette do tend to come to the front, as we see Mikey who we told had been hearing from the pits, had a big shunt on the first lap, which is why he's as far back as he is. So undoubtedly he's going to be trying as hard as he can now to claw his way back to the front of the GT board as we resume action now with the fight for second place in the LMP class, as Charles is still resisting the forces of Ayrton Schumacher, and Mini Stiggy still keeping a watching brief there in fourth place, but perhaps not quite as close yet as we thought he could have been. But of course,
I think he was closer beforehand, so I think maybe he's lost a little bit of time, perhaps a little mistake, a bit of a problem maybe as he put his foot to the floor with obviously the turbo and some of the issues they do have in that Audi, getting the power down. Maybe that was a mistake from the American driver.
Could be, or of course GT traffic could forever play its part in this, as we've seen many times this season, particularly with Chozza at, was it Willow Springs, where he had multiple contacts with GT traffic. He's struggled with that this season in particular. He's always renowned for perhaps making mistakes in terms of losing concentration, spinning off, as he got a bit out of shape on the exit of the Retafilo chicane. But yeah, so far this year he's had a particular problem with GT traffic.
Yeah, maybe sometimes just pushing the envelope slightly too far in the pursuit of extra time. But of course, sometimes that's what drivers just do, isn't it? It's a case of having the visor down and doing all they can to win, and just sometimes maybe pushing 1 or 2% over the edge.
Indeed, as we've often seen, he's certainly very fast on his day, but as we see Mini Stiggy there kicking up some gravel on the exit of the second Lesmo, so you're right, he's certainly pushing in that Audi.
Yeah, he is, of course. I'm thinking that perhaps Stiggy has perhaps gone with a low downforce setup, lower than some of his competition, just to really amplify the strengths his car has in a straight line, and go all out on the straights, and maybe that's costing him around the corners such as Parabolica, the Lesmos, do you think?
It could most probably be the case, as we've seen the Pescarolo is particularly strong through the two Lesmo corners and Ascari, so undoubtedly perhaps the Audi has taken the wing off to exploit its colossal firepower, really. And as we see Charles making a bit of a mistake there, coming through the second apex of the Retafilo, and that's once again put Ayrton Schumacher close behind him.
It has indeed. Looks like Schumacher might be trying up the inside here. It's going to be brave if he does. No, he doesn't. That's probably a wise move from the British driver there.
Yeah, so he's already seen what Chozza will do in defending a position, and is renowned as a late breaker. So he's certainly going to have to get well alongside Pescarolo driver before making an attempt to overtake. And that little dice there has allowed Mini Stiggy to catch back up again, as Glenn appears to be falling ever further behind, and Memso still recovering there from his earlier off at the Curva Grande.
Yeah, and just a thought, obviously, even though Schumacher is a first-timer in the WEC, I'm fairly sure he'll have done his homework. He will know that Pescarolo is perhaps a couple of miles per hour down on the straights, and he will try and make his move there, as we see him, I think, try and go up, say, up the inside unsuccessfully at the Parabolica.
Now, I say, Parabolica is a brave place to overtake there. You've definitely got to be alongside someone, as he's lining him up, though, for the first chicane again. Is he going to have a go this time? He's going down the inside, and is he making it stick? He is. Yeah, he has dispatched on the Pescarolo. So that is the Bentley of Ayrton Schumacher in second place. But as we know, Chozza will not be fighting back as much as certainly the Bentley driver would like. And is he going to have a go down to second chicane? He's certainly going to think about going down the outside, which would certainly be brave. But no, unfortunately, you kind of get the feeling now that that's going to be the driver released.
Yes, and look at this. We have a certain Mini Stiggy suddenly a whole lot closer to the back of that Pescarolo.
Yeah, and now Charles is going to have to keep an eye still on that Bentley in front of him as they want to get back past, and also watch his mirrors to stop that Audi from sailing past as well, as there is a substantial difference in terms of straight line speed between those two, so he might find it more difficult than he'd like. But let's now see if the Bentley driver can do anything about Ninjin, who is now in the lead to the tune of about 8.8 seconds as it stands. So undoubtedly Ayrton Schumacher's got a lot of ground to make up.
He does indeed have a very substantial amount of ground to make up, and Nin consistently keeping that half second per lap going on as well, isn't he, according to that time.
It certainly is. He just bangs them out lap after lap after lap, as Chozza is having a look at Ayrton Schumacher trying to get second place back, but he's going to have to settle for it, as the Audi getting out of shape there once again. So clearly Mini Stig is still having problems harnessing his throttle control in that Audi.
Definitely the case. It must be very difficult when you're in the heat of a battle to remember that perhaps you have to be a little careful as you apply the power, and you just think, oh, you've got to keep up, and you just dump your foot to the floor and you just spin it up and you nearly crash, and I'm sure on some occasions you do end up crashing and spinning.
Yeah, as we see there, I think it was McLaren of Mikey getting in the way. Well, not getting in the way, of course, he's perfectly entitled to keep his line as he wishes. So he got in between the Bentley and the Pescuero there as they were going through the first of the Lesmos, which enabled Ayrton Schumacher to get away just a bit from his pursuers. So he definitely will have broken his slipstream a bit from the Pescuero, and now leave the poor Chozza to be worrying about that ever closing Audi behind him.
He will indeed. That's never a good sign, of course. Stiggy is a good driver, and as we saw at Brands Hatch, he did quite well for himself for a first-time competitor, and he could well be right up here today as the race goes on. And he has, look, taken third on the scoreboard.
He has. I was watching from on board the Audi there as he closed so much on that Pescuero at the end of the straight there, the top end speeds. Undoubtedly, it was a good 20 miles an hour, almost faster in that Audi, and there was nothing Chozza could do about that. He just left the door wide open for him to come waltzing down the inside, as if to say, after you, mate, I've got nothing to respond to that. So that is the American now up into third place, and now both of them can set about that Peugeot in the lead. But of course, as we say, there's still a substantial gap between the pair of them, which is now to the tune of 9.3 seconds. So even with clean air now, the Bentley's not actually catching the Peugeot as of yet, although that's in the last lap, 131 dead for Nin versus a 31.3 for Ayrton Schumacher. But as we say, it's ebbing and flowing depending on traffic, and you start to think it's time actually for the Pescuero, and usually starting to struggle with tyre wear as we're on lap 18 now for the LMP. So you've got to think that tyre wear is starting to become a factor at this stage.
Yes, that does seem highly likely, and I'm just thinking here, obviously these three drivers in the second, third and fourth positions are having a great battle here. It's great for us watching, but do you think that perhaps they'd be a little wiser to just team up and use the slipstream to try and catch Nin?
That would be the sensible option, wouldn't it? But of course they're racing at the end. It's all TNR Philo running very wide there out of the second chicane, and almost lost it before getting to the first set of Lesmos. Managed to claw it back though, and is on his way once again, but that could have been a very messy moment there for the second of the Pescuero drivers.
Trying to make up the time he lost in the early stages. Obviously we saw him limping back to the pit lane only after about five laps, so he's pushing hard, arguably a little too hard, to try and get back onto terms with the rest of the LMP field.
As we we've still got an hour and a half for this race still to run, so he could theoretically do it, but as we've seen so far, the Pescarolo not necessarily the strongest car around here, but it could come good later in the race though, so we'll have to see what kind of progress he can make. But for the time being, of course, it's still Ninchen leading from Ayrton Schumacher. So Chun at the moment of 9.3 seconds. So the gap is sort of hovering at the moment around the 9 second mark, as Ayrton Schumacher has posted a 30.9 to Nin's 31.1. So as we said, a gap ebbing and flowing by tenths of a second per lap at the moment. Mini Stiggy about 2.3 seconds behind Ayrton Schumacher at the moment, and lapping similar pace as well. They're all very similar pace, as Chozza has gone into the pit lane. So the Pescarolo clearly has been munching its tyres a bit too much, and he is headed for the sanctuary of the pit lane to get some fresh Michelins from the oven and some fresh fuel from the fridge as well, and hopefully he can set about closing the gap again afterwards.
Yes, and look, on the scoring board, has Mini Stiggy pitted as well, because Glen Owls is suddenly ahead of him.
He has. I'm not sure what's happening, as the live timing is indicating that neither Glen or Mini Stiggy have made a pit stop yet. Although, Mini Stiggy, a 33 second first sector compared to the normal 25 and 26 is so. Evidence suggests that he's lost 8 seconds somewhere in that first sector, so I wouldn't be too surprised if he's gone off again coming out of turn one, as we've seen him struggling so often there. So it seems a mistake from the American has now put the other Bentley up into third place.
Perhaps maybe even a repeat of the Mento 89 mistake at the Curva Grande as well. You can't rule that out either, but either way,
it's always we see him going off. Just as we talk of mistakes at the Curva Grande, the lead Peugeot has then run it wide himself coming out of there. So highly unusual mistakes like that. Yeah, so not sure at the moment if he's sustained any damage. We'll see if he decides to pit within the next lap or so, as we do now see Mini Stiggy in the pit lane. And it's time to see if that mistake, so I think to the tune of 8 seconds, that should put Chozza back in front of him. But we shall have to wait and see at the moment, as we see Memso coming out of the power bollocker. Also, someone making up ground. You have to say, it's not been easy for Memso, as he's been thrown into that purge at the last minute due to Immortal partly being unable to show up. So he's probably had to throw a setup together at the last second and not really knowing what he's done to it.
Yeah, and that's never a good thing when you just like hope rather than know that your car is going to perform well.
Yeah, so of course, as the Peugeot sort of been the lead car for the whole season. I mean, you look at the first race at Indianapolis, where he sort of comfortably won, and then Szabo did the business on race two to score them the win. Same again at Daytona. And then, of course, at Willow Springs, when Immortal Pilot started showing up, and we had two Peugeots duking it out for the lead then. So far, I believe they've won most of the races, haven't they? As of course, Chozza won race two at Brands Hatch, or was it race one he won? I believe it was race two, wasn't it?
It was, yes. Either way, it was not a good race for the Peugeot teams. It's the one time we've seen the Peugeot team's faltering a bit, because of course before Chozza was in the lead, we had Mento 89 and the Bentley out front. So it was a tough day for those teams in the Peugeot machinery.
It was, yeah, the two friends between Chozza and Mento having a great fight for the lead on that day, and it was great to watch. And it certainly made some entertaining racing, as we see Nin still commanding.
Nin,
I don't think he's made a pit stop yet, has he? Glen have still.
Whoa!
This time he definitely has gone off there at the Parabolica. Has he touched the barriers though? Either way, you'd think he's going to dive. No, he carries on amazingly.
Yeah, I'm relatively surprised by that. I wasn't expecting him to get away, or not so much get away with that one, but can decide to continue on after that mistake.
Yeah, you would think the sensible thing would be to pit if you're starting short, as we see that Ayrton Schumacher is now in the pit, so we just see if he can rejoin in front of Chosler as well and hold on to his net second place in this, as we see Nico, who is still quite comfortably leading the GTE field. It's a tune of what's the gap between himself and it's a good 41 seconds at the moment between himself and David B there, so Nico's quite comfortably got his
moment. Pitted from second, didn't he?
Cavani, he has pitted, yes, and although he's still some 4 seconds behind Mikey, who in turn is about two behind David, so even allowing for the time of a pit stop, Nico's still comfortably controlling his one.
Definitely the case, just like the Swedish driver is having a bit of a walk in the park here in the Corvette.
He certainly is, and of course Monza is a royal park, so it's a very fitting metaphor, that one, Adam.
I was going to leave that as an Easter egg for those who knew that fact, but yeah, okay.
Of course, Monza, the royal park, and as the Italians call it, La Pista Magica, the magic track. With the cathedral of speed, it's certainly got its fair share of magical nicknames, this place.
Yeah, it's a magnificent circuit. Of course, it's one of the tracks that lasted throughout all the various changes in terms of safety and ethos in terms of track design. It's always been on the calendar, right up there at the top of global motorsport, which is brilliant to see, really.
Oh yeah, absolutely. As we see Mikey closing up towards David B, so Mikey has perhaps finally got his way on terms with the sort of midfield of the GT team, so it might not be long before we see Mikey clawing his way up into second place amongst the GT teams. And as of course we say, he's got a long way to go to catch Nico, who is currently in the pits and exiting them now, so he should still quite comfortably hang on to lead of the GT field.
Yeah, definitely. Looks as if he has it all under control out there in the vet.
Yep, certainly got very little to challenge him at the moment, but of course, still got an hour and 22 minutes of this race to go, so still plenty of things can and will happen in this race, so it'll be interesting to watch the developments as further up at the front, Nin still leading from Glenn, who has not yet made a pit stop, I don't think, and no, he hasn't, so our talk earlier on about the Bentley perhaps being hardest on its tyres proving to be untrue at the moment, as Chozza, I'm watching on the screen, has just gone off coming out of Ascari and is currently riding along the barriers. He's dropped it coming out of the Ascari, and that has put Mini Stiggy now up into fourth place as Glenn comes into the pit, so the inevitable mistake has finally happened, as we've seen dropping out to the fifth place for the Pescarello driver.
Yeah, I mean, he was having a good performance out there. I reckon he still has a lot in him. I think he can get that car repaired if he has damage. It looks as if he does, because he is now in the pit. Yeah, if he can get that car back out there and just, you know, take some deep breaths and put a pedal to the metal once more, I think he's still in with the shout of the podium here today.
As we say, never rule anything out, as we see Mikey having a look on David B going through the Parabolica, but he decides better that one as he can line up the Mazda coming down the straight, as we see the race leader hoping to get in on the action, hoping not to cause any problems, of course, between the pair of them, as Nin has come into the pits finally. So that is all the LMP leaders are now pitting, whether on strategy or as stakes have unfolded. So Nin should comfortably retain the lead in LMP, as he had a 43 second lead over Ayrton Schumacher, as we see Mikey once again lining up the Mazda going into the Roger chicane, and once again holding back, as he's still got time to work about this, as they're all running wide there on the exit of the chicane. and it's giving him a run down into the first of the left post, and he's done
ambitious. I thought he was slightly too far back on that occasion, but no, he's proved me wrong. So
yep, he went for it, and David B saw him coming and gave him the room, which is very fair of the Australian. And that has now put Mikey up into second of the GTs, so he can set about closing down the rather substantial gap between himself. Although it's actually not as big as I thought it was now that Nico has just recently pitted, of course. So the gap between himself and Mikey is on the region of 9 seconds at the moment. But of course, Mikey's been out for some 19 laps now on his set of tyres. So you'd think a pit stop is not too far away, perhaps, for Mikey. Although, how long can the GT cars competitively run a set of tyres around here, Adam? Do we know?
I would have thought that they should be in within the next few minutes, and I think David has actually run out of tyres, judging by the fact that he's had a couple of moments in the recent laps and is now in. So I think we should see them all come in before we see lap 27 or lap 28 on that scoreboard.
Yeah, I'll say David B was actually the only runner who hadn't yet made his first necessary pit stop. So that is now all of the runners having made their pit stop. Some, the likes of Memso and Chozza, have made two owing to mistakes, as we now watch the Pescarolo driver again getting a bit leery there, coming out of the first of the Lesmos, as he's clearly pushing for all his worth to try and make up for that mistake. As you'd think, in terms of pace, he might struggle to catch up with the likes of Mini Stiggy and Ayrton Schumacher, but certainly his aim now would be to catch Glenn for fourth place by the end of his race, and then not give his teammate too much work to do tomorrow.
Yes, and one thing I'd like to point out about a lap ago, you were saying about David B. Giving Mikey room at the Lesmo corner when he made that move. David, throughout the season, has just carried on going around the track consistently while others have made mistakes or made wrong calls in terms of strategy or even retired from the race. And he's just been there to pick up the pieces because he has been consistent. And that is one of the key things in endurance racing. I mean, at the end of the day, there might be some people sitting watching, you know, thinking, I'd like to be a part of this, but I can't really keep up with the likes of, say, Ninchin or RS and Kane, two very quick drivers in the GTE category. But at the end of the day, if you can just keep going around the track and not giving up, you will find degrees of success in the series, and podiums and possibly even race wins will come your way if you just stick to that strategy of keeping out of trouble.
Absolutely, as we've seen in quite a lot of cases, consistency is better than just, you know, going a million miles an hour and never to making mistakes, a la the Pescarolo driver of Chozza, compared to certainly likes of Glenn, very consistent, and Nin, of course, who's got a fantastic consistency to him, as well as, of course, being exceptionally fast. So undoubtedly is an example of someone who's getting the very best out of himself and the machinery at his disposal.
Yes, I think one driver who's I can highlight as someone who's been relatively consistent all throughout the season, Red Bull Rider 20. He's been doing very well for himself just through consistency.
Yeah, you say he's sort of got... Continue.
There you go.
I was going to say, of course, you got two very contrasting teammates in the form of the American Red Bull Rider and the Englishman Chozza 32. So the two of them do gel together to make a very interesting lineup, which has given them some success so far in the Pescarolo, but not the wins that they'd have liked. But of course, overall victory has so far eluded everyone who hasn't been equipped with a Peugeot 908.
I'll say this, it's one thing that disappoints me, actually, how those two drivers are separated by the Atlantic Ocean, hence the team name Atlantic Alliance Racing.
Absolutely.
I think they'd be a very good team for our other flagship event, the N24. You've got that mix of raw speed and almost computer-like consistency, and I think that's exactly what an N24 team needs. maybe we could see them in future seasons, maybe. Maybe just making that journey to meet up with each other and launching a campaign on that legendary race.
It certainly would be something to desire, but of course, got plenty of exciting teams as it stands in the N24, the likes of Concrete Climax with Memto and Chozza working together in the N24 to win, of course, a few months ago in the 2014 race where, of course, we had such a fantastic race with P24 and CCR battling for the full 24 hours to claim outright victory, as the consistency of the Polish team was just metronomic and meant that, as we see Memto, is he looking to lap TNF? I think he is. So Clear is expecting the Pescaro to probably get out of his way more than he's being lapped, but we do see that with sort of multi-class racing. In particular, of course, it's the job of the GTs to stick to their line and let the faster cars find their way past. But then you've got, because of the two race format, you've got people in race one who perhaps don't want to be lapped as soon as someone gets behind them, because of course giving away a lap to your competitors means your teammates got to work so much harder in race two. So you do get a lot of let's say casual neglect of the blue flags at times.
Yeah, strategical neglect.
Yes, that's a better term for it. Strategic neglect, as we see third place Audi coming up to lap the second place GT runner, and of course pick up some dust there on the exit of the second chicane, but of course we've seen plenty of that so far. No one's made any major errors yet at the second chicane, but
no.
I think this would be a good time, Adam, to let's talk about the championship overall now, because of course this is race 6 of, I think it's a 14 race calendar, so we've got 8 to go after this, so we're nearing half distance. And of course at the moment we've still got Thar, the team of Nin and Zobo on screen with at the moment, leading quite comfortably on 53 points compared to relative newcomers of IMP, who've got 35, and Atlantic Alliance on 33, Concrete Climax on 28, and then ASR on 18. So at the moment, you have to say the Peugeots have got a pretty good hold on the championship overall, but can we realistically see someone coming back at them later on in the season?
To be honest, I do think it would take quite the overturn for Nin, Chin and Zovemir van Basten to give up what looks to be their championship. However, it only takes a couple of mistakes to define their whole season and lose points. You know, it's by no means over, but it's going to take a few uncharacteristic mistakes from the two Peugeot competitors and Thar teammates to perhaps give the likes of CCR and AAR and IMP the chance to take that crown.
Yeah, as you say, we've got three double points races coming up after this in the form of Le Mans, Silverstone and Spa, albeit all of them separated by a good 4 or 5 weeks at a time. But of course, with double points on offer, there's definitely opportunity there for people to make some serious inroads on the leads in both championships, of course, because we've got Fangit Racing leading the GT Championship, of course, the team of Widfo and RS96. The rapid German.
He's incredible, isn't he? He's one of the quickest drivers I've seen in a GTE car on Gran Turismo and Core for a very, very long time.
Indeed, a very special talent. I always wonder how the series would have been shaped if we had him around from the very beginning in season one, because of course in the early days certainly much more interesting with different regulations back then. Of course in season one it was Chozza actually who took the GT championship in the Ford GT, so some cars have maintained their strengths in the series throughout the varying seasons. I mean, the Peugeot has been sort of the car to have since the first season, of course, and swept all before it in season two, and so far even more so in season three. And of course the Ford GT as well has always been a pretty good car across the series, so certainly the cars to have if you want to be fighting it out for the championship.
Yes, and I was thinking actually a few weeks ago, with remember the likes. Was in the GTE Bentley class in their day, and I can imagine, I mean, obviously I know that Core are looking into running various championships in the future. Now imagine the battles we could have if there was ever to be a standalone GT series. How good would that be?
It certainly would be something quite spectacular. As good as multi-class racing is, of course, you do get some instances where battles are broken up by traffic coming through, as we saw on the Parabolica there. Something we've seen a lot from the Bentleys this season, where in particular in putting the power down and taking long corners, there's always a lot of smoke coming off the tyres from that thing. So again, you think there's some stiff damping problem.
Do you think the car's slightly too stiff, Chozza? Surely?
It could be too stiff, or if they haven't got the damping right for that level of stiffness. But you have to say, certainly as dramatic as it looks, it doesn't appear to be affecting the car in this race, as of course Ayrton Schumacher 5.4 seconds at the moment behind Nin, so he made some gains initially on the lead Peugeot during the first round of pit stops, but then over the last few laps Nin's gradually again been ebbing away at that lead and drag it back out, as we've now got the Audi a good 10 seconds or so now behind the Bentley, and Glenn a further 18 behind Mini Stiggy, with Chozza then further 23 behind Glenn. So it's all starting to space out a little bit now, but undoubtedly Ayrton Schumacher will not be giving up in his pursuit of the lead.
No, I don't see him giving up anytime soon. He already shown himself, to me at least, to be a very determined driver in the little under an hour that he's been with us in this season. And I think he will continue to try and find those lap times and try and close that gap to Nin in the Peugeot.
Yeah, of course I'd forgotten he's only 1 hour experience in this event so far. As Nin kicks up some dust on the exit of Lesmos, and I believe I couldn't see there in the background that was someone as well, so really kicking up dust on the exit of Lesmo 2 is the popular thing to do today, as there's a particular line to be taken through Ascari, with them allowed to run nearly all four wheels over the inside curb of the first left-handed apex, and then run all over the concrete on the final left-handed apex as well, so you're certainly allowed to take a lot of time going through a sky, aren't you, by jumping over curbs and the likes?
Yeah.
But curb hopping can be dangerous, of course, but of course these guys are all professional enough to control their machinery, as we ride now with the Audi coming out of the Parabolica, and now switch to second place Ayrton Schumacher negotiating the apex of the first chicane, where that's a prime example of somewhere where it's very easy for the driver to spin off, as of course we've seen a couple of times now from the Audi driver.
Yeah, we have seen a lot of that actually. Not good for tyres, I don't think.
No, you're certainly going to spin up the rears a lot, aren't you, when you're coming off those corners if you're a bit too hasty to throttle, as we see some of that from Mikey there at the moment, as the Bentley driver dispatches with another GT car in his pursuit of the leading Peugeot in a gap which at the moment is the tune of, it's about 6 seconds at the moment, so Nin's still doing his best to gradually pull away from his pursuers.
Yeah, Nin's definitely he's doing very well for himself today. I've always been impressed by his performances, but I think this one is going to stand out as one of the most dominant displays I have seen this season, I say with 1 hour and 5 minutes to go. Hopefully I haven't put the commentator's curse on him with that statement.
I think Nin's perhaps a bit too consistent to allow the likes of us to curse him. And of course, yeah, this is a track that was theoretically supposed to put the Peugeots at a disadvantage, as although it's been renowned so far as a really good all-round machine, it's perhaps potential straight line speeds were not as good as the Bentley or the Audi, so it should have shown up here, but nope, Lynn's still plugging away as we seem to be having some technical problems here with the screen.
Yes, and hopefully the core technical department will be working on that. Now, do you think Mini Stiggy will be a top contender for victory next round at Le Mans, considering the prolific straight line advantage of that Audi?
Again, in theory, that should be the case, as there's a much greater straight to corner ratio at Le Mans than we've got here at Monza. So you would think the Audi would really be able to stretch its legs around the Saab. But of course, Le Mans brings its own challenges as well to it. There'll be a night race at points this year, as the races will split up into two lots of 12 hours. So of course, some people will start on the day, finish at night, and then race two drivers will start at night and finish in the day. So that brings its own unique set of challenges to it, and certainly driving at night is always a case of how good the lights on your car are, as some people do tend to struggle driving at night with seeing where they're going, and as we've seen in real Le Mans, can lead to incidents aplenty at night time. As let's run through the proceedings as things stand here with 57 minutes gone by. Nin Chin leading from the word go, from pole position, still leading fairly comfortably with a 6.5 second lead over Ayrton Schumacher, and also with the fastest lap of the race at the moment at a 1:30.050. Let's say the Bentley driver 6 seconds now behind Nin Chin, fastest lap of a 30.4. So in terms of ultimate speed at the moment, he's still missing some pace to the Peugeot driver, but as I said, still got an hour left for that to change. Mini Stiggy holding that third place now, some way behind Ayrton Schumacher, but still quite comfortably ahead of Glenn, posting a fast lap of a 30.2. Glenn running solidly in fourth place, but with the Pescarolo of Chosen bearing down on him, who has himself with a 30.7, and then said Chozza 30.2 for a fast lap as well. So times are fairly consistent across the board at the moment.
Yes, they definitely are. And back to your talk, you're talking about Le Mans. Now, I happen to know that you're rather more successful than me when it comes to getting drivers to sit down and talk about the technical aspects of their role. And I've always considered Le Mans to be, I find it very strange that they use low downforce setups. Now, my reasoning behind that is that from the Porsche curves through to Tertre Rouge and the Mulsanne straight, there are a lot of fast sweeping bends, and I just can't see that being easy with a low downforce configuration. Am I maybe being a bit too weak on that one?
No, of course, it's a balance which we see play out at Le Mans each year, with some people who prefer to favour the higher downforce to get them around the Porsche curves easier at the expense of straight line speed. But of course, each time, as I say, we've only been to Le Mans once before in the core WEC series. Last year it was a season opener, and that was when we had multiple tyre choices in the race, where you had to run a soft and medium compound, where the medium tyres you had to run consecutively for 40 minutes. which perhaps meant you would have favoured a bit more downforce because the medium tyres works a bit better when you weren't, you know, spinning them up constantly, as they had a horrible tendency once they went off to really lose some grip. And well, we had less power last year as well, so that favoured itself more towards, you know, shedding some drag to actually get some decent speed out of the car. So this year, with a lot more power on board, it's going to be interesting to see which way people go. Sort of time will tell, really, as to how that one plays out. But you'd certainly think the Audi maybe wouldn't have to shed too much downforce, actually, to maintain its strong straight-line speed. But you certainly think the Peugeot and the Pescarola would definitely have to, otherwise they are just going to get gobbled up on the straights with very little resistance.
Yeah, so I was thinking, actually, brought back a few memories. Back towards the end of the Gran Turismo 5 era of Core Racing, obviously we ran the Core Group C Championship, which was a very spectacular class, and I tried to enter that. And I distinctly remember once again, Mento 89, trying to increase my speed through setup tips. And I said, oh, I'm running this aero. And he just says, well, you should be running about 200 ticks less. And I was just saying, no, because I'm just not capable of keeping the car going around those sweeping Porsche curves without having it go off. And I think once again, I've talked several times in the past about what makes the difference between a decent driver, an average driver, a good driver, and some of the top tier, some of the top run drivers, is the fact that they can deal with certain aspects of the circuit that perhaps don't suit their setup to capitalise on other sections of the track.
Yes, certainly the great drivers are able to drive around problems better than some of the drivers, aren't they? But it all comes with experience at the end of the day. I mean, this is one of those things where experience and just continuously driving, eventually you get to grips with it and can overcome the issues. But for the time being, let's back to the action. So as we follow Cabani, who has fallen away now from his original position a while ago, where, let's not forget, in the early stages he was right behind Nico fighting for the GT lead, and now has dropped back behind Mikey and David B. So things not going well at the moment for Cabani.
No, actually, I am surprised to have seen him drop off like that. I've always thought of Cabani as one of the more consistent drivers in the GT category, but obviously today maybe not his day, but he can still, you know, challenge for third, second, or even possibly the win. It only takes a little bit of a slip up from Nico Demus.
It certainly does, but Nico at the moment, the Swedish driver, certainly not looking like he wants to relinquish the lead of the GT class anytime soon, so it's going to be something pretty special for Nico to stop him, as he currently holds a 48 second lead over Mikey in the McLaren. So even after clawing back some of the original time he lost, Mikey's not been able to do too much, actually, about Nico in the lead. So at the moment, things are looking very comfortable for the Corvette driver. And Cabani's certainly having to work hard at the moment just to try and stay with David in the Mazda. Although David's been on the... Oh, it's because Cabani's made his second pit stop. That's why he's dropped down to the back. So Cabani just recovering from his second stops, and at the moment looking to close in on David B, who is still on his first set of tyres, as we've just seen Memzo enter the pit and now Chozza in as well. So once again, the Pescarolo hasn't gone that far, actually, considering he stopped quite late on, having crashed after making his first pit stop. So the Pescarolo, clearly tricky to drive and not very good on its tyres at the moment, which is very unusual. So far this year, it's been up there with Peugeot in terms of being able to keep its rubber in check.
Perhaps is it having to lean on its tyres a bit more as it has to have a bit less downforce in order to compensate for the slight lack of straight line speed in comparison to some of its LMP rivals.
It's possible, but I'd spoken with Chozza before the race, and I think he's running a relatively high downforce setup in the Pescarello. As he said, running it in low downforce trim made it incredibly unstable under braking and through corners, and although it was very competitive down the straights after that, it just lost too much time then under brakes and through the corners. So his solution was, you know, might as well stick to playing with the straights, as we see Cabani now on the back of the Mazda. And has he managed to nerf it aside in parabolica? Hasn't quite, but he's certainly going to look to pass the Australian down the pit straight.
Getting a hell of a lot closer here. I think it won't be long before Cobani makes his move on those fresh tyres.
He's certainly got the grip advantage at the moment, but the Mazda's clearly got the advantage down the straight, so he's not been able to do anything about it just yet, but he'll certainly be looking to perhaps have another go at him going into the Roger chicane. But we see the Mazda inching away ever so slightly down the straight, well, you can't call it a straight curve, grand. It is what it is, a grand curve, as Cabani pokes his nose down the inside of David V going into that second chicane and almost tip the Australian to a spin there, as Nin now splits the two of them as they go through first at Lesmos, but forces David B a bit wide there on the exit. So we then see one of the Pescarellos, and that's Chozza now, who's been lapped coming through as well, which has split up this fight a little bit. But of course Cabani has got a tyre advantage at the moment, so it shouldn't be too long before he's crawling over the gearbox of that Mazda again.
Yeah, and do you think that perhaps Cobani would be wise just to wait for David to make a pit stop, as all sorts of chaos going on here there?
That would be the wise decision, as he was all over the rear wing of the Australian there, as the Mazda got out of shape coming through Ascari, and Cobani looked to take advantage coming out of the corner, but couldn't quite do anything with it because he had nowhere ready to go, and then had to back off as we see Ayrton Schumacher going in to make his second pit stop. So he'll be looking to try and undercut Ninchen again, although we suspect Nin will certainly be a good two, possibly three laps later in for his pit stop, because of course it was about three laps last time, the difference between the two in terms of pit stops, as the good mechanical grip of the Ford there, well, it's fresh tyres, helped him through the first chicane. And once again, thinking about trying to line up the Mazda for the second chicane, but the Mazda once again pulls away, so the Ford not really able to exploit its strengths at the moment, as he thinks about going down the inside, but thinks better of it. So he can tell he wants to get the move done and dusted so he can exploit his better grip, but can't really seem to do much with it at the moment.
No, it's, I'm quite surprised by it, actually. I thought this might be a...
As he nerfs him there, coming out of the second Lesmo.
Yeah, he's looking into it, isn't he?
I say he's right at mine now. He'll be definitely getting the best of the toe here, as down... not quite close enough to go, ever go into Ascari, but got to give him some credit. They might be trying. He's certainly throwing everything he can at the Australian, and he's not quite cracking yet, is David B, so... consistency certainly helping at the moment, but he might have yet another stab here going into the parabolica. No, he's too far back again. No, he's not, actually. Oh, it's a bit messy here as he made contact with the Mazda and was forced onto the inside there, so he's actually lost some ground there, and perhaps think he does need to be a bit calmer doing this, because he could warrant a penalty pretty soon if he keeps making that sort of contact.
Yes, that's something he does have to be a little bit careful of there. That was quite the heart in the mouth moment there. I thought there might have been a bit more gravel and barrier involved in that smash, but fortunately not the case.
As we rise with Chozza at the moment, who has been lapped recently by Dennis. We see Memento coming into the pits again. So clearly another problem for the standing driver in the Peugeot 908. And he's now made, I believe, his third pit stop along with Chozza. So yeah, things not looking too encouraging at the moment for Memento.
Clearly maybe not happy with this new experience and indeed, of course, this new setup.
Yeah, clearly, as we mentioned earlier, he was thrown into it at the last minute, as we see Ninchin now entering the pit. So this is squeaky bum time for Ayrton Schumacher, whether he's going to be able to jump Ninchin in the pit stops. It'd be surprising if he did, as Ayrton Schumacher is coming out of Ascari now, and Nin, how far? He's sort of halfway down the pit lane, but Nin's away already, so Nin should comfortably retain the lead here as he's passing the last of the pit crews in the pit lane and off the limiter now. And does he stay within the white lines? Yep, Nin keeping it nice and down the middle there as to not try and warrant a penalty. So, oh, he breaks very late for turn one though, just about gets away with it and stays in front of the GT traffic. As Ayrton Schumacher is not even into, but he is now into the first chicane. So the gap pretty static, if at best, for Ayrton Schumacher. Might even be slightly larger actually than when he first came in, but we'll wait for the first sector split to tell us that. So it was two laps this time that Nin went a bit longer, as Cavani, well out of shape once again in his pursuit of David B's Mazda. So he's clearly getting a bit frustrated behind the wheel of that Ford.
Yeah, maybe pushing slightly too hard for his own good. Will that go against him eventually?
You'd have to think law of averages eventually says one of these tiny errors is perhaps going to lead to something a bit more damaging for his race prospects. But I say David B's now been on this set of tyres for 17 laps, and we saw him go a good 20 laps or so plus on his first set. So theoretically he could still be out for another 5 laps or so, as we now follow Memento in
he's Memento had a problem there. Yeah, I've had a spin there, I believe.
Yeah, a spin and coming out of... Oh, dear. Well, there's evidence to the struggles he's having in that Peugeot today. As, obviously, although he's in a different livery compared to the normal IMP team, of course, Memento does not have that particular livery at his disposal, but he is part of Team IMP for this race, filling in a course.
Big moment!
Well, that's all, and Cavani's collected the Mazda as which LMP was that, Adam, that came through and caused the issue there for him?
It was Glenn, yes.
Glenn has got himself into a bit of an issue there with GT traffic, as now Cavani running wide. He might have a bit of damage actually, although it was very light contact he had with David B, who undoubtedly will have suffered quite badly from that, as we now see Glenn being I think Mini Stiggy's made his pit stop, so Mini Stiggy has now taken over third place, and Glenn will undoubtedly have to come into the pits this lap to get rid of that damage.
Yes, he will indeed. Now, I maybe shouldn't draw attention to this, but a few minutes ago you mentioned Glenn having what was called squeaky bum time. Now, I need to know exactly what that means.
It was squeaky bum time for Ayrton Schumacher. Basically, it was his time to get on with it and perhaps get a bit closer to the limit in his efforts to try and catch down on Ninchin, efforts which don't appear to have paid off too much, as it's now a 10 second gap between the leader and Ayrton Schumacher. At the moment, the question is Glenn going to drop down behind Chozza as a result of this incident? I think he may do, as at the moment, Glenn is still coming down the pit. Oh, this will be close, as Chozza's just launching off the parabolica at the moment. I think Glenn's finally off the pit limiter. So, oh, we're watching Chozza trying to steal a sneaky slipstream on Glenn as he's come out the pits, but he has just made it out in front of the Bentley. So that is Chozza now up into fourth place.
Yeah, I was actually expecting Glenn to just manage to keep that fourth position, but apparently not. So now he's got it all to do again. I'm sure he'll be attacking the back of that Pescarolo.
Yeah, certainly, and perhaps Chozza will give us an opportunity to instead break away from Glenn, as I think it's hard to tell now because Glenn's had to make an unnecessary pit stop, but I think he'd have been due one soon anyway, so perhaps there is the need for Chozza to make an extra pit stop compared to the Bentley, so he'll be trying to set about building up a big lead.
Indeed he will. I definitely think there is life in this race yet.
Yeah, there's still plenty to go on in this race. So let's stick with the action. Hope that it'll have a meaningful conclusion between the fight between Chozza and Glenn. Although at the moment, the Pescarolo appears to be drawing away from the Bentley.
Yes, indeed. And you might have heard that in the background there, one of the dogs of the Royal Park getting into our commentary box. Fortunately, our ever vigilant core backroom staff got rid of that in record time. So fortunate stuff.
Yes, fortunate. There is a very, it is an unusual thing to happen during a race, but stranger things have happened. As
I'm
lucky,
I'm just glad that dog came to us.
Dogs on track.
Yes, exactly. I was very happy that the dog came to us rather than onto the circuit. A repeat of that Bruno Senna accident a few years ago in GP2, where he actually hit a wild dog in Istanbul.
He did, as Mikey.
Mikey. Big off.
Yes, and Mikey clearly. Yeah, so he's certainly I'll give that an 8 out of 10 for effort to get that far off the track. So, certainly not going to do his prospects of catching Nico any good at the moment. But as Nin looks to be getting a bit out of shape there. Off the second chicane, trying to pass David B.
Yeah, a little bit out of shape, but as ever, has suddenly found his composure once more and keeps on his way.
Indeed, but over the last few laps, Ayrton Schumacher has taken just over a second out of the lead Peugeot, so perhaps as the race goes on, the Peugeot's starting to wane a little bit, but as there's still plenty of time for him to respond to the threat, and in fact, as we speak, sector time so far on this lap are, well, it's 2/10 to the Bentley in sector 1 and 3 to Ninchin in sector 2. So far on this lap, it's a 1/10 of a second to the way of the. Oh, as Chozza.
Look at this on screen, yes, Chozza.
Second chicane and let Glenn back up into fourth place as he's recovered quickly from that one, but that's cost him a good 7 odd seconds, and it looks as if he thumped the inside curb there on the left hand apex. Very, very hard, and clearly spat him off into the gravel. So he's got it all to do once again as the other Pescarolo goes off.
Clearly
leading by example today. Yeah, so they're clearly on the limit around this track, which is always expected to be their least favourite as well. So yeah, they're certainly having a tricky time of it today.
Yes, and of course, as you pointed out earlier, these curbs, those two chicanes, very unforgiving, and that shows it, doesn't it, very well.
Yeah, that does demonstrate the technical aspects of how he can get it very wrong very easily around the first and second chicane. Be interested to see if Chozza sustained any damage from that. I don't think he did. I think he just wound up into gravel. So saw steam and much red mist protruding from that yellow crash helmet. So he's going to have the bit between his teeth now to try and catch Glenn once again.
Yes, fortunately enough, he has that off at the chicane, which is a relatively low speed section of track, and he had the gravel as well to aid in stopping him, so he didn't quite end up thumping the barrier. Of course, the same did not apply for Philo, who was still going very high speed in the braking zone of the corner when he lost it, and he took a very hefty amount of damage, I imagine, after that contact with the barrier.
Yeah, so it certainly looked less favourable for Philo, as he's still going at the moment, and I don't think he's made another pit stop, so he's either continuing with some damage or has made an unseen pit stop. But as I say, he's a multitude of laps now behind
Cavani, huge moment there.
I say, yeah, he's clearly struggling somewhat at the moment with that Ford, so dear, it's really not looking good for Cavani as things go bad from bad to worse for the Dutch driver. So yeah, certainly could do a lot better at the moment, but keeps making mistakes.
It does indeed. It's a tough time for the Dutch driver at the moment, just doesn't seem to be able to keep it on the straight and narrow.
No, say, clearly the cars which normally favour high-speed corners, such as the Ford and the Pescarolo, sort of demonstrating really that they're just not suited to this track. As let's see, the number of high-speed corners around here is approximately, what, one maybe in the form of a Scari, but in terms of, perhaps the Lesmos as well, but certainly not enough meat to the track, figuratively speaking, for these cars to get their teeth into.
I think, yeah, those cars will come good once more. But the next round, of course, that's in Mon, but after that, isn't it Silverstone next on the calendar? After Le Mans?
Yes, Silverstone after Le Mans. There's a 6-week gap between the race at Le Sarthe and then the race at the home of British Motorsports, which surely the British drivers will be looking forward to, as even though it's not quite the same as perhaps thumping around it in a Formula One car in the British Grand Prix, it's always nice to drive around a track that you're perhaps familiar with and even visited previously, as I'm sure many of us have been to Silverstone at one time or another for either track days or racing events itself.
Yes, definitely the case. And I must say that 6-week gap, the amount of updates Polyphony Digital have been throwing our way as of late. I mean, that race is still, what, at this point, 8 weeks away. Do you reckon we might even see another update that perhaps changes physics and setups and everything else before we get to that round? Will it all change once more, as we've already seen a couple of times during this season?
I would not be at all surprised if that was the case. And we've heard word that there is an update on the way to include the Red Bull Ring to Gran Turismo 6, and in terms of cars, the Toyota TS03 will be coming to Gran Turismo 6 as well. So there's another LMP for people to enjoy, as we see Philo once again getting very squirrely coming out of the first chicane, as we track Nico, who's put a lap on David B. So Nico, quite comfortable, able to control things as he wishes, really, still at the front of the GT field, as the same really, perhaps Nin's having a bit of a harder time of it, because of course Ayrton Schumacher 8.6 seconds behind the gap. So last lap around, they were both as near as makes a difference. identical lap times, both 30.5s last time around.
Yeah, new mistake behind, in fairness. Anything could still happen at this point in the race. We still have a quarter of this half of the race, race one of two, to go.
Yeah, so it's gone by quite quickly, hasn't it? It's been a fast pace, really, because also a 1 minute 30 is it's a fast lap around Monza. I mean, a Formula One car, I believe the out-and-out fastest lap ever conducted by a car around here was Juan Pablo Montoya back in 2004, and won the pre-quali sessions, did a 19.5, I believe, as the
official
fastest lap ever.
I'd be quite surprised if it was a 2004 car. I remember that seeing a bit of a dog, but perhaps since this is a high-speed track, maybe Montoya managed to capitalise on the fact that he didn't have to go through too many corners.
Yeah, say plenty of grunt from his BMW Williams in those days, and plenty of grunt from the Audi here on screen at the moment, as he's holding a fairly comfortable third place at the moment. His Mini Sirimi, well, actually he's some 7 seconds behind Ayrton Schumacher at the moment, so he's narrowed the deficit a little bit, so there's 15 seconds overall at the moment, covering the top three, with Glenn now some 52 seconds further back, with Chozza less than 3 seconds now behind Glenn, still trying to recover from that mistake. In fact, I do lose that Chozza there just behind Glenn that we can see.
I think it is. I don't think it's the other Pescarolo follow. It is indeed Chozza 32, so this could be an interesting moment in the race.
It could, as clearly Glenn perhaps held up a little bit there by the Mazda going through Ascari, as for moments that see again a lot of smoke coming off the tyres of the Bentley. It's clearly just how they have to run that car to get the speed out of it, and plenty of evidence in this race so far that it's finally coming good, as in the earlier race of the season it was fielded in Indianapolis at the time by I can't remember who the team was now. I'm appalled to say, but
I do remember one of the drivers was Andre R35, I believe.
Yes, Andre. Yes, because he was running second for much of the race at Indianapolis.
The course statistics department has told me it was Bar Bar Racing. What an interesting name. I'd rather wish they'd kept on a bit longer. I'd have liked to have said that name several times throughout our broadcasts, but unfortunately they had to withdraw in the early stages. But they did make quite the impact.
Yes.
I think they did quite well in their brief time in the series.
Yes, as I say, it was holding a very competitive second place in much of the race, as at the time the Audis were not competitive at all. If I remember at Indianapolis, they were really nowhere, weren't they? Sort of. Normally you'd expect cars string out quite a lot on the infield section of Indianapolis, as it's a very understeery layout, isn't it? And yet we're watching the Pescarolo that used to crawl all over the back of them in the midfield section, and then the Audis, it was then we realised just how fast we were down the straights. But it was just, as we remember to say at the time, no good through the corners, terrible under braking. I mean, updates have since, of course, made it a much more competitive prospect, but in the early couple of races it was really not the car to have, was it?
No, it was not. And I must say, I got to that paddock for the opening round of the series thinking, well, you know, Concrete Climax, Audi, we've seen what's happened when those two names have appeared together before back at the N24.
Absolutely.
In February. And I was thinking, well, this is going to be the season of Audi and indeed the season of Concrete Climax. And well, in the early stages at least, how wrong was I?
Yeah, so I think we all expected a lot more from the Audi R18 initially than it actually delivered, and it was very disappointing, as it could perhaps be argued that the stock car, I think, developed about 530 horsepower, and then we ended up increasing it by about 200 for core regulations, as Charles has taken a big bite out of Glenn in the second sector and ever closing up on the back of the Bentley. But looking at the tyres, he's almost out of fuel, is Charles, so within a lap or two he's gonna have to come in to sort that out, as he in fact comes in now. So you've got to be careful coming off Parabolica into the pits there, as if you just drive straight in without any consideration, the pit lane very kindly spits you backwards somewhat to punish you for coming in too fast. So you've got to be careful going to the pits not to lose an extra few seconds with that. So it's much easier to be cautious and perhaps give away a few tenths by not attacking it as much, as opposed to being too aggressive and losing a multitude of seconds that way, as the Pesco now trundles down the pit lane. And we ride with your GT leader, Nico Demus, who is now, as ever, a substantial gap ahead of Mikey. His lead is now over a minute from the McLaren driver. So Nico clearly driving brilliantly this afternoon, wouldn't you agree?
Definitely the case. I think Nico's put in one of the best performances I've seen from the driver since N24. I remember him being very good and consistent for Gore in February in that very striking blue Mercedes that they ran, and he's proving himself yet again to be one of the better drivers behind the wheel of a front-engine GT car.
So I can't imagine a front-wheel drive car being terribly competitive
a
within
front-wheel
the
front-wheel drive Corvette. Now that needs to happen.
Yes, perhaps we need to speak to the race organisers and get some front-wheel drive tournaments going. We've received instant clarification from Core HQ that no, that will not happen.
Yes, I do think that's probably against the spirit of the GT regulations, suddenly allowing manufacturers to show up with different drivetrains. So, good decision there from everyone at Core, as we see Mento 89 here, sixth position. A bit lonely, really, when you consider Philo's very far back, and I believe Charles is quite some way ahead.
Yeah, so Memto is a whole lap behind Chozza, and therefore two down on Nin. So at the moment, when I was here, it takes over for the second race. He's going to be some way behind anyway. And so far this season, I was here has done well to maintain the gap built up in race one by Immortal Pilot and then give them the overall win. So it'll be interesting to see in race two if he can go on the offensive to claw back this deficit, because as it stands at the moment, he's going to have a couple of laps at the least to try and make up for in race two. So that'll be interesting to see what he can do then, as we ride now with Cabani, who is a bit lonely now, actually, as Mikey is some 36 seconds down the road from him. And David B, I'm not sure what happened to David, because he's now dropped a lap behind him.
Yes, indeed, actually. That's a bit of an odd one. And apparently an off-screen crash. Our cameras didn't quite catch that incident. Now, we're talking about various forms of racing, and we're talking front-wheel drive racing. That got shot down. But I was talking to some of the core staff earlier today. They were, hinting to a few projects possibly coming. We are obviously renowned for our endurance racing here at Core, the successful and now I'd say legendary in Gran Turismo terms Nürburgring 24-hour event. But I think we might soon be looking towards races that are more sprint-based, perhaps some touring cars. I've heard many talks of global rallycross as well, which I find extremely exciting. So I think Core may be in the future looking to prove that we are not all about endurance racing.
Yeah, that's certainly be an interesting lineup to Core's already brilliant array of races. We say, of course, the World Endurance Championship, the N24, and on the lighter side of things, the Fun Cup, which is quite different, is it not, from the sort of serious nature of the WEC and the N24.
Where Core comes to play the Fun Cup.
Yes, I say it's not really a race, is it? It's just anarchy with a bit of driving involved as well, which it does live up to its name, the Fun Cup. It is most definitely a fun's evening entertainment. We've also got the Super GT tournament lineups, the likes of the various Nissan GTR race cars, the GT500s, all lined up. So that'll be an interesting championship when that gets launched. So many good things definitely in the pipeline. As going back to current events, Mini Stiggy, having just made his pit stop, comfortably retains third place now. And dustbin kicks up there, didn't see who that's from. As Ayrton Schumacher now 7 seconds behind Nin. So ever so gradually he is whistling into that lead, but it's taken him a long time to whistle away. Goodness, that was I only assume that was some kind of an issue with that there.
We've seen interesting things go on throughout this year, but I think that's a new high.
Yes, I say that certainly be terrifying to be on board with. So luckily no one came out of that unharmed. So Mikey and Nin on their way. So again we ride with Memento. It's quite nice livery he's got there on that Peugeot, the white with orange wheels. That could be a personal point of view, but
ask him about that. Actually, those who followed the N24 thread in the build up to the Nürburgring 24 Hours, many of the cars in those promo pics were orange, and he simply replied, "Orange is my colour, deal with it." And I think as the time has gone on, I agree with him. I do like that orange.
Yeah, it's certainly an attractive paint scheme. As we are now into the closing stage of this race with just 22 minutes left on the clock. So it's difficult to see whether Ayrton Schumacher can do anything about Nin in the remaining stages, but undoubtedly he's not given up so far this race, and damned if he's going to give up this late on. So perhaps there's still something to come. You never know, Nin could crack up from fatigue in the latter stages, although he's so far shown to be able to handle it all pretty well, as Ayrton Shuey is running a bit low on fuel at the moment. So nope, carries on for one more lap at least. So clearly he's likes to play it dangerously.
Yes, indeed. And Pikey Mikey at the moment, we're on with here. And I think, you know, Pike's done pretty well for himself today. He hasn't had the best of races, but we were talking about the McLaren not being strong here. And considering that, I think, you know, it's been a good race.
Yes, as I say, he had an unseen incident on lap one where he went off and hit the wall, so clearly he's always going to struggle to recover from such a bad start as that, as Nico has now made his third pit stop, which has now put him and Mikey equal in terms of pit stops, which is why he had such a big lead previously, but still with a 27 second lead over the pursuing McLaren, it's therefore still got its quite comfortably in hand. As we look, looking at fastest laps on the GT cars, it is MyQ actually, who has put up the fastest one in the 40.2 compared to Nico's 40.7. So perhaps an out and out lap pace McLaren has had it, but I say we don't know the circumstances in which sometimes these fastest laps are set. So he could have had a toe off someone for we know, but Nico perhaps hasn't been pushing as much as he can do as Ayrton Schumacher heads for the pit lane.
Yes, indeed he is, and I'm not sure whether he's gonna keep Stiggy behind him. Do you think he's got enough advantage?
He had 40 seconds of a lead, so he should just about be able to hang on to his second place. It'll be very close. Mini Stiggy coming out of the parabolica at the moment, and Ayrton Schumacher getting out of the pit, although I think he might have grazed the white line though as he was coming out of the pit lane. So undoubtedly the stewards will be having a look at that later on, as they're very strict in terms of white line infringements. It's clear cut in the rules. You've got to keep all four wheels within inside those white lines. If you stray over them as much as even touch them, you will incur a 30-second penalty. And if the stewards review the footage, of course, we have a multitude of stewards to review incidents to come to a decision on something. And if they do deem that Ayrton Schumacher has gone over those lines, then sadly he will incur a penalty, which will be unfortunate if he did, because of course it's all taken away from Nin. As speak of the devil, he has come to a rest in his pit box, and will undoubtedly be filling up for the final stint of the race. This will be actually, I don't think Ed Schumacher is going to be close enough to capitalize on this, as Nin won't have to take on much fuel, and sure enough he's away already, trundling down the pit lane. Let's keep an eye on him to make sure he keeps it within the white lines. Normally he's very professional and does so, and at the moment Nin, he's getting close to one left, but crucially does stay within them, as Ayrton Schumacher only goes over the finish line now. So Nin still holding a comfortable lead at this stage, as interestingly enough, on the last lap, Charles 32 has just pumped out the fastest lap of the race so far, and the first person to dip under the 90-second barrier with a 1:29.903. So, in the closing stage of the race, the Pescarolo suddenly found some pace from somewhere.
Yeah, quite surprised by that actually, but perhaps just as time has worn on, maybe car and driver are getting adapted to this circuit, and they're finding more and more pace as a unit of sorts.
Yeah, most likely the case is, or perhaps is figured with just, was it now, 17 minutes or so left on the clock, that I'll go hell for leather in his attempt to clutch Glenn, as he's still a fair way behind the Bentley driver, who has not come in yet for his third pit stop. So Glenn will have to come in at some point, as he does not have the fuel on board to get him to the end of the race. Although, with that said, Chozza, he might have to start saving some fuel at some point in the near future, as this is looking a bit close at the moment. So he may need to reassess how he's attacking this racetrack, because if he carries on that kind of pace, he'll definitely struggle to get to the end of this, because of course it's not just the 16 minutes and a half that we've got left. It'll be whether the race leader then has to complete much more of his final lap as well on top of that. So I hope Chos has factored that in, otherwise he'll be able to make a splash and dash at the end to get him through. But perhaps he's sorted that out, but as I say, time will tell. Glenn Deppy does have to stop again.
Yeah, I would have thought so. And just a note, you might have noticed a couple of very prominent teams, as a matter of fact, Professor Duck Motorsport and Fangit Racing Team are not being represented here today. Now, both drivers did actually turn up to the qualification, but it was Plux and RS, and but unfortunately the two drivers were disconnected and they were forced to retire before the race got underway, so a very unfortunate turn of events for two very quick drivers here.
Yes, it is very unfortunate, as under court regulations it's a three-car minimum disconnection needs to occur before a full field restart can happen, so yeah, unfortunate for those two there.
Yeah, unfortunately, I bet they were both hoping that someone else would disconnect, but unfortunately it wasn't the case. But one team that won't be sorry to see those two drivers and those two teams basically out of the running this weekend, TMBO closing up on FRT in the points table. So, you know, this is something that's happened for them. So, advantage TMBO.
Yes, so TMBO, which is Cabani and Kane at the moment, although they're the third in the GT class, so they'll certainly take some points away, as they're 14 at the moment behind FTR in the championship, so they'll definitely take a sizable chunk out of that lead by the end of this race, because of course even if they do field a car in race two, there's no way they'll be able to claw back anything other than last place, unless of course a disconnection occurs to the guys in TMBO as well.
Yeah, that would be truly unfortunate, that would be.
Certainly would be. As we are approaching the final 10 minutes of this race, with 13 and a half minutes still on the clock, Nin Chin still leads us from the word go. He's not relinquished his lead at any point, so at the moment he's not quite on for a grand slam, which would of course be pole position, fastest lap, every lap led, and the race winners at the moment. Of Chozza has deprived him of the fastest lap privilege, and then he'll have to respond some point soon if he'd like to sort that out, as one of the recent updates to Gran Turismo involved the race leaders, or the fastest lap overall in the race, being put up on the screen, so you know throughout the race who has done the fastest lap time. It doesn't help people in GT, of course, because they cannot do anything about a 1 minute 30 or 1 minute 29, but of course the guys duking out the front can see who's got the fastest lap and whether they want to then do anything about it, because of course there's a point to be gained from fastest lap, so it's often worth having a go at least.
I often hear it in the Formula One, or at least you did last year, not so much this year, because Red Bull have rekindled the idea of a Renault-powered little teapot that blows up and stops working all the time, like 1977. Yes. But last year, at least, you carried on hearing Sebastian Vettel's team engineer telling him rather frantically to calm down, stop going for like fastest lap on the last lap, and mostly because there's absolutely no reason to do it. But of course here in the core WEC there is of course reason to do it. There's points at stake, and at the end of the day one point could make all the difference.
Absolutely. I mean, Sebastian Vettel just did it for fun, didn't he? Whereas you're right, there is literally a point to
be made
as once again, dear, his race is just going from bad to worse to dreadful. I mean, promising at the start, wasn't he? In second place at the time, but Glenn in the pits at the moment. It won't be a long stop for the Bentley driver, of course, because there's only 12 or 11 minutes even left of this race. So, but Chozza has passed him nonetheless. Although, as I say, Chozza's still. He might still need to come in and make a pit stop himself later on, though he's showing more, just over a quarter of a tank of fuel left at the moment, so it'll be interesting. Let's Leave it at that. And at the moment, he doesn't appear to be doing too much to actually save any fuel. So he's not aware of the situation or just doesn't care.
Yes, there's Cabani limping back. And I'm not sure Cabani is going to be too happy with himself, because he will likely be third or possibly fourth. However, if he'd had a better race, he could have capitalised even more on the unfortunate did not start marks next to Cluxon RS, FRT and PDM. But unfortunately, due to these various issues he's had, he's not going to capitalise on that quite as much as he could have done.
No, yeah, that is sadly the case at the moment, so he'll be heading away with third place at best, it seems, as, interesting incident that's going down the back straight there between Ascari and Parabolica, where Philo, clearly with a damaged car, almost causing a collision between himself and the other Pescarolo, as Chozza unsure which way he was going to go, and kind of an interesting moment there for the say lead Pescarolo runner at the moment in fourth place, as is something of a PR disaster for the two of them to run into each other.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, poor Philo, much like Memto, has been thrown into the deep end by All Star Racing, who had to back their drivers out last minute, and Philo drew the short straw and was told terribly long before the race, hey buddy, you've got a ride in the Pescarolo in the WEC, which, you know, it's a good thing, but it can also be someone's worst nightmare.
Cabani's off yet again. Just approached the first of the Lesmo corners. I was on our separate screen on board with Chozza, and there was the unfortunate sight of watching a Ford GT scrape itself along the inside wall there. So from bad to worse to dreadful to downright diabolical now for the Ford GT driver, although he's still for the time being ahead of David B, who is some 2 minutes behind Cabani on the timing. So you'd think perhaps once he's limped his way back to the pits that the Australian might be able to pounce on the 4GT. So as I say, Cabani does appear to have a substantial amount of damage at the moment, so really it's all fallen apart in the last 10 minutes of the race for him, as David B's negotiating the first chicane at the moment. And Cabani just about once again scraping on the barrier coming out of Ascari, and really crawling on a good 70 miles an hour at the moment and can't really go much faster than that. So actually he should be able to go back to the pits and still maintain his third place, but undoubtedly he will not be happy with himself at the end of this one.
No, he won't. It's unfortunate, but it happens to the best of us. And all the best, even the best drivers, have their off days in this series. And unfortunately, Cabani, as I was about to say, has been blessed. But of course, he hasn't been blessed. He has been cursed with one of those off days today here at Monza.
Yes, as we now go on with Ayrton Schumacher, who has been nibbling a bit more at the lead of Ninh Chin. The gap now down to 5.2 seconds, so he's still throwing everything he's got at it. Last lap around a 30.2 for Ayrton versus a 30.3 for Ninh, so it is only tenths of a second between them at the moment, but you never know, he could still pressure the podium driver into a mistake, and that's clearly what he's relying on. Mini Stiggy now a further 13 seconds back. He's almost certainly sealed third place with Chozza almost a minute behind him. So
at the end of the day, it bodes well for the future, really, for Buster Hyman Engineering and Ayrton Schumacher, because he hasn't really been threatening Ninh Chin as such in terms of like an on-track battle. He's definitely been showing himself to have the same kind of pace as Ninh Chin, not only proving that Ayrton Schumacher is a very strong force as a driver, but also proving that these cars are extremely well balanced. So, you know, all in all, this bodes well for future rounds of the core WEC Championship.
Yep, absolutely. Hats off to the, as we see, Mikey, right there, impeding the leader some there's Ayrton Schumacher. Had the gap down to 4.4 just before Nin encountered that McLaren. Then it could come down even more so once they reached the end of the second sector. So I'd be interested to see what that cost him there. As as I'm saying, it's a credible job to Core HQ for specking the cars in the first place. They are that they undoubtedly do have their characteristical differences, as we've been talking through the broadcast. The Audi, brilliant in a straight line, but perhaps suffers a little bit under braking and cornering compared to the others. Then you've got the Pescarolo, which is the opposite. You know, it's immense through high-speed corners. Seems pretty good on the brakes. Of course, its acceleration in particular where it struggles compared to the others, because it is the heaviest of the lot and also the least powered. Then we've got the all-rounder, really, the Peugeot 908, which just seems to have a good turn of speed under every circumstance, isn't it? There's very rarely a day where it's not at the front end of the field.
Yeah.
And the Bentley's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah. Bentley is an interesting car, isn't it?
Yeah, say, as Ayrton Schumacher clearly finding it a bit difficult to lap the other Bentley at the moment, and losing out some time there undoubtedly to Nin, as the gap was let's say last lap around they were pegged for the same lap times, but now it's very interesting reading for the actually to sort of confirm how well specs of cars are. Out and out fastest laps, Nin Chin 30.050, Ayrton Schumacher 30.001, Mini Stiggy 30.037, Chozza 29.903. There's a tenth and a half gap between the top four in terms of out and out fastest laps. So that's very impressive. That's four different manufacturers as well, of course, with those times in the form of obviously the Peugeot, Bentley, Pescarolo and Audi. So there's wanted confirmation on how close they are. There it is. Yep, as you can see on screen at the moment.
Yes, and I'll say this. I mean, at the end of the day, I know some drivers sometimes, understandably so, are a bit downhearted when it comes to a circuit where their car perhaps, you know, doesn't get much chance to show off its strengths, but if all the cars were absolutely identical, what would be the point? It may as well just be a one-make series if it was going to be like that. I love the fact that the cars have these little quirks to them, these little characteristics. I think it's part of what makes racing.
It certainly is, as we saw. Obviously, the Peugeot's been good everywhere, but the Pescarolo was strong at Brands Hatch and Willow Springs. The Audi's obviously proving good here, so it's always likely that your car will suit a track at least. So there'll always be a good day for you to counteract the bad days. Of course, if you're driving a Peugeot 908, there very rarely seems to be a bad day, so it's always good for them.
I'll say this. My top tips, right, for the teams. I reckon the car to beat at Madrid and possibly Suzuka, as well as the Red Bull Ring, that if it does indeed come to this game, I'm hoping it does, and if it does get included in the game, I'm fairly sure Core would be tempted to include it in the WEC. I cross my fingers, pray and hope to Polyphony Digital for that one. But those two tracks, possibly three tracks, will be Pescarolo circuits. Le Mans next up will be an Audi circuit, I think.
Yes, the form book would suggest that. Although Silverstone, that should be a good fight between Pescarolo and Peugeot, as there's lots of high speed corners at Silverstone, of course. Although back now, to the action.
I have a hunch. I actually, just quickly, I have a hunch that Bentley are going to come strong at Silverstone, I reckon. I'm not just saying it because I'm a Patriot, and also not just because they won in the Blancpain Endurance Series there with the Continental GT3. But I just have a feeling that with Bentley and that circuit will gel on the day.
Yep, could well happen, as Chozza, in the end, he has had to pit. He ran out of fuel, or as near as. So, the Pescarolo driver has had to throw it in with seconds left on the clock to give it a splash and dash to make it to the end now. So, that's dropped him now, the lap behind Ninja that he did not want to lose, really. And your race leader now does start his final lap of the race. Been unchallenged really all race long. I mean, Ayrton Schumacher has closed up a little bit recently, gap now down to 3.8 seconds, as on his last lap Ayrton Schumacher does his personal best lap of the race at 29.994, so only the second driver so far to dip under the 1:30s. He's certainly still throwing everything at it, is Ayrton Schumacher, but it's Nin, really, isn't it? He's got this all under control.
Yes, and I must say, Chozza 32, I feel sorry for him there. I distinctly remember on Gran Turismo 5, I had a race at this very circuit. I ran out of fuel with about 4 or 5 laps to go from the lead, and I was a mess after that. It took me a while to recover, but you know, he's got back underway, he's still fifth, he's got decent points, he's got a consistent driver. Tomorrow, in the form of Red Bull rider 20 to take over that Pescarolo, and things could still go AAR's way as Ninchin approaches the finish line.
Yep, Ninchin has dominated the race here at Monza, race one, and crosses the line to claim another brilliant victory for the Peugeot driver. Ayrton Schumacher, an exceptional debut, you'd have to say, to come home in second place in the end. Some 3.6 seconds behind Nin, who gave it his best that he could. Mini Stiggy should be crossing the line for third position. Glenn, somewhere behind, should pick up his fourth place, as Chozza, a lap behind, cannot complete another lap, so he is nailed into fifth. Memso will be nailed into sixth place as well, with Philo in seventh. And then, talk of other dominant drivers, Nico Demas, another brilliant performance from him in the Corvette to claim GT top honours, some way ahead of Pikey Mikey, who will take second place. Cabani, in the end, did manage to hang on to third place, although I'm sure he'll be immensely disappointed himself. And David B, rounding up the GT runners in the field in fourth place. Well, Adam, it's certainly been a fascinating race, and we look forward to race two.
Indeed we do. So here are the results. Ninchin wins again in that Peugeot 908 for Farr. Ayrton Schumacher for Bustenheim Engineering is just 3.661 seconds down on him, however, with Mini Stiggy in the ICR Audi just 21 seconds back. Glen Owls 81 is 1:44 down in the CCR Bentley, while Chozza 32 is 1:56.776 down in the AAR Pescarolo, with Memto 89 sixth place in the Peugeot. TNR Philo rounds out the field 10:34 seconds behind, reserving for ASR. On to GTE, and as we said, Nico putting in a brilliant display to take the win in the CMS Corvette, with Pikey Mikey 34.7 seconds behind him in the Made For Racing McLaren. Cobani comes home third with 2:03 behind in the TMB Orange Ford, with David B 6165 rounding out the top four. AGHG comes home fifth, while Psycho Para comes home in sixth. On we go, and Plucks the Duck and RS96 both did not start today's race for various connection reasons. Join us next time on the Core WEC.